do you believe that the digital dollar will eventually be the mark of the beast? And if so, do you believe that we are living in the book of Revelation right now?
Well, we kind of have digital dollars now. I mean, I very seldom carry cash with me anymore. I carry a debit card and pay for everything with my debit card. Other people use a credit card, but I tend to use a debit card, and that involves a digital exchange of dollars. So we've actually had that for a long time. Why would you suppose that merely an electronic exchange of currency would be the mark of the beast?
From what I understand, once the digital dollar becomes an actual clip in the body, becomes an actual insert into the body, then that would separate us from the grace of God, and we would be siding with the Antichrist.
So I'm glad that you brought up the idea of having an implant of some kind. And people have talked about having like an RFID chip, so you don't have to carry your credit or debit card around with you. You just have an RFID chip, and instead of waving your card over a reader, you wave your hand over the reader. Yeah, it's possible that that technology could come about. But I don't think that it's what the mark of the beast is. There's a lot of speculation that you have to engage in to get to that point. What you find when you study the history of this issue is that every time a new form of currency exchange has been developed, people will link it to the mark of the beast. They did the same thing with credit cards. They did the same thing with because you carry your credit card around in your hand, so that must be the mark of the beast. They did it with social security numbers, because you get a social security card and it's got a number on it, and you carry that around in your hand, at least when you have it out of your wallet. And so they even did it with vaccines. In Russia, in the 19th century, they would say, oh, if you take a vaccine, it, you know, that's the mark of the beast. So people have been kind of mark of the beast crazy. I mean, very anxious to see the mark of the beast in all kinds of things. And they can't all be true. So what I'll do is I'll give you a recommendation for where you can get a lot more information about this for free. And then I'll give you a short answer for right now. The place where you can get a lot more information for free is in episode 138. Of my podcast, Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. I did the whole thing on the Mark of the Beast. So you can get to that. You can go to my YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/Jimmy Akin, and just search that channel for Mark of the Beast. Or you could type in Jimmy Akin Mark of the Beast into YouTube or Google. Or you could go to mysterious.fm/138, since it's episode 138. One of the things about the Mark of the Beast is it doesn't just say in Revelation that it's on your hand. It could also be on your forehead. And so I wouldn't look at having a chip in your hand as a definite sign of the Mark of the Beast. Also, we're told that the mark is a specific number. It's 666, or in a few manuscripts, 616. But the whole point of having a chip in your hand is it's like having a credit card in your hand. Your credit card, Psychelet, has a different number than my credit card, because that's the only way to keep track of whose money is whose, is if each card has a different number. And, well, if all the numbers are 666, then we wouldn't be able to use credit cards, because there would be only one bank account we'd be drawing on. And so that's just not how credit card accounts or debit card accounts work. And in the same way, if at some point in the future we had chips in our hands that we could use the way we use credit cards right now, then they would each have to have their own individual number. And so none of their numbers would be 666. And so that's a reason to say, you know, I think that there's some speculation going on here that's beyond what the text really indicates. Because it's, now some people might say, oh, but the first three numbers might be 666. Well, A, that's pure speculation. We don't know that's going to be the case. And second, why would that be the case? That wouldn't make any sense. You know, why would you add on extra numbers you don't need to do the transaction? And thirdly, the numbers are still not going to be 666. Even if 666 are the first three numbers, all the rest of them are going to be different. So it's still not the number 666. What you find when you, and there's way more about this than I can go into at the moment, unfortunately, when you study the book of Revelation in context, it says that the vision is to tell Jesus' disciples what will happen soon. It says that at the beginning of the book and at the end of the book. And so that tells us, as our first pass interpretation, we should interpret at least the beginning of the book and most of the book as something that would be soon from the perspective of John's audience living in the first century. However, at the end of the book, we're clearly on the new heaven and the new earth, so there needs to be some way to get from the first century over this long period of time before the new heaven and the new earth. So we want to look through Revelation to see, is there a passage in Revelation that refers to a long period of time that could bridge the first century and the end of the world? And the answer is, yes, there is. It's in chapter 20. It's a long period of time symbolized as a millennium or 1,000 years, which 1,000 years is just a stock number for something very large. And so based on how Revelation stresses this is to reveal what's going to happen soon and that it was written in the first century, that would tell us the first 19 chapters of Revelation should be read as pertaining to the first century. We're now living in chapter 20. We're in the millennium right now, where Christ is reigning in heaven and through his church on earth, and the devil is bound in such a way that he cannot deceive the nations. He can't stop the proclamation of the gospel, as evidenced by the fact a third of humanity is now Christian. So this is very different than it was in the first century when Christians were a tiny, tiny minority in a sea of pagan darkness. So if we interpret the first 19 chapters as having to do with the first century, what would that suggest about the mark of the beast? Well, one of the things we know about the mark of the beast is that the beast has seven heads, which we are told are seven kings and seven mountains. Okay, since very early times in the church, it's been recognized that the seven mountains are the seven hills of Rome, and the seven kings are seven pagan Roman emperors. Then we also learned that this beast persecutes Christians, which the Roman emperors did, and it wants to be worshipped as a god, which the Roman emperors did, and it's got the number of 666, which we're told is the number of a man. So does the number 666 correspond to any of the Roman emperors? Yeah. If you take Nero Caesar and you add it up, in either Hebrew or Aramaic, it adds up to 666. Or, you spell it a little differently, it adds up to 616, the variant number that exists in a few manuscripts. So that tells us that early Christians recognized the beast is connected with the Roman emperors and with Nero in particular. So that would suggest that what the mark of the beast is not a credit card, it's not a chip, it's not something like that. Instead, it's allegiance to the Roman cult of emperor worship. If you're willing to put your head and your hand in the service of worshiping the emperor, like using your head to, you know, to proclaim the emperor as a deity and using your hand to like pick up incense and throw it on the emperor's altar, then you get let into society and you can buy and sell. Whereas if you refrain from doing those things, if you refrain from the cult of emperor worship, you may be excluded. The mark of the beast is also contrasted with the mark of the lamb, which is what we see in Revelation 14. You know, there are no chapter divisions in the Greek New Testament, and it's really unfortunate that they decided to put a chapter division between chapters 13 and 14 because people read about the Mark of the Beast and then they stop. If they kept reading just a few more verses, they'd learn about the Mark of the Lamb, which is put on the foreheads of the followers of the Lamb. And that's not a physical mark. It's not a physical thing. It's a spiritual mark that is invisibly put on people by angels on the followers of Christ. So we should understand the Mark of the Beast in the same way. It's not a physical mark. It's a spiritual mark that signifies you worship the emperor instead of you worship Christ. Now, could there be a future echo of the Mark of the Beast? Well, yeah, there could be a future echo of it, but what it would signify is not I'm using a digital dollar or I'm using a credit card or whatever. It would signify I worship something other than Jesus. I'm worshiping some future world leader who is like Nero and wants me to worship him as God. And as long as you're not doing that, you haven't received the Mark of the Beast. So we don't need to worry about specific technologies. What we need to worry about is, are we worshiping Jesus as God or are we worshiping someone other than Jesus as God?
Hey, thanks for watching. If you like this Catholic Answer, be sure to like, subscribe, and check out our live streams Monday through Friday, 3 to 5 p.m. Pacific. Or find the episode after on YouTube, your favorite podcast platform, or our Catholic Answers app.